Good morning. This week we're going to be covering the final three sections about probability. Concepts of probability, conditional probability, and probability trees. First, let me remind you about union and intersection. If A and B are sets, or for us events, then A union B is every simple event which is in either A or B. A intersection B is every simple event which is in both A and B. For example, let's suppose we're rolling a single die. The sample space, so that's the set of all possible outcomes, is the set containing the numbers from 1 to 6. We're going to assume that each of these simple events is equally likely. In other words, the die is fair. We're equally likely to get a 6 as we are to get a 1. Two questions. What is the probability of rolling a number which is even and greater than 3? What is the probability of rolling a number which is even or greater than 3? Let A be the set of even numbers in our sample space, and let B be the set of numbers greater than 3 in our sample space. So A is the numbers 2, 4, and 6. B is the numbers 4, 5, and 6. What is the probability of rolling a number which is both even and greater than 3? We're looking for the probability of A intersection B. A intersection B has 2 elements. The sample space has 6 elements, so the probability is 2 divided by 6. What is the probability of rolling a number which is even or greater than 3? In other words, what is the probability of A union B? A union B, all of the numbers which are in either A or B, is the set containing 2, 4, 5, and 6. This set contains 4 elements, so the probability of A union B is 4 divided by the number of elements in the sample space, 4 divided by 6. Let me remind you of the addition principle from last week. If we wanted to count the number of elements in A union B, we can take the number of elements A plus the number of elements in B, but then some of the elements we may have counted twice, so we subtract the number of elements in A intersection B. We have a similar formula for probabilities. The probability of A union B is the probability of A plus the probability of B minus the probability of A intersection B. Now let's suppose we're rolling 2 dice. First question, what is the probability that the sum is either 5 or 10? And question 2, what is the probability that the sum is greater than 9 or both dice show the same number? First of all, let's look at the sum is 5 or 10. We need 2 compound events. Let's suppose A is the compound event that the sum is equal to 5. How can we get 5 from 2 dice? We could have 1 and 4, 2 and 3, 3 and 2, or 4 and 1. Let B be the compound event that the sum is equal to 10. To get 10 from 2 dice, we can either have 4 and 6, 5 and 5, or 6 and 4. you can notice that A intersection B is empty. So we don't need to worry about the probability of A intersection B for this example. The probability of A union B would just be the probability of A plus the probability of B. When we roll two dice, each die has six possible outcomes, so that means in total there's 36 different outcomes. So the number of elements in the sample space will be 36. The number of elements in A is 4, so that's 4 divided by 36, plus the number of elements in B, which is 3, so 3 divided by 36, or 7 divided by 36. What is the probability that the sum is greater than 10, or we have the same number appearing on both dice? Let C be the compound event that the sum is greater than 9, 4, 6, 5, 5, 5, 6, etc. And let D be the compound event that both dice show the same number, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, etc. Note that here the intersection between these two compound events is not empty. The intersection between C and D contains two elements. Therefore, we can use our formula. The probability of C union D, the probability that C occurs or D occurs, is the probability of C plus the probability of D minus the probability of C intersection D. And when we put the numbers in, 6 over 36 plus 6 over 36 minus 2 over 36, we get 10 over 36 or 5 over 18. Complements. Let me remind you that if A is a set or a compound event, A complement is everything which is not in A. We have a nice theorem. The probability of an event E is equal to 1 minus the probability of E complement. This can be useful for us because sometimes it's easier to calculate 1 minus the probability of E complement that it is to calculate PE directly. For example, a box containing 45 whiteboard markers is delivered to Istanbul Okan University. 9 of the markers are red. The remaining 36 markers are black. Your teacher is given 10 markers at random. He will be happy if one or more of his markers is red. Now, because there are only 9 red markers, if I get 10 markers, at least one of them will be black, but maybe all of them will be black. The question is, what is the probability that I will be happy? In other words, what is the probability that I will get at least one red pen? Now, what we could do is we could calculate the probability that I get one red pen, the probability that I get two red pens, the probability that I get three red pens, etc., up to the probability that I get 9 red pens. And then we could add these probabilities together. But we're not going to do that because there's an easier way. What we're going to do is we're going to calculate the probability that all of my 10 markers are black, and then we're going to do 1 minus of this probability. So let E be the compound event that one or more of my markers is red. Then the opposite of E, E complement, is that all 10 markers are black. We know how to calculate the probability of E complement. the number of elements in E complement divided by the number of elements in the sample space. Let's look at the sample space first. There's 45 markers, and I'm going to receive 10 of them. How many different ways are there of choosing 10 out of 45? 45C10 ways. How many different ways are there of giving me 10 black markers? 36 black markers in total. So 36C10 ways to give me 10 black markers. And then the probability that I receive at least one red marker is 1 minus the probability that all of my markers are black, or 1 minus this number. And when we calculate this with a calculator, we find that this is approximately 0.92. Now I'm going to take a 5-minute break. Now let's continue. Next example, in a class of 30 students, what is the probability that at least two students have the same birthday? And I mean the same month and the same day, not bothered about being born in the same year. And just to make our calculations slightly easier, let's ignore the 29th of February. So let's assume that we have 365 days in a year. And let's suppose that each day is equally likely as a student's birthday. Then the first student can be born on any one of 365 days. The second student could be born on any one of 365 days. The third student could be born on any one of 365 days, etc. So we have 365 multiplied by 365 multiplied by 365, etc. In other words, the number of elements in the sample space will be 365 to the power of 30. Let's suppose that our compound event is that two or more people have the same birthday. It's going to be easier to calculate the probability of E complement. E complement is the probability that all 30 students have different birthdays. We're going to calculate the probability of E complement, and then we're going to do 1 minus this number to find the probability of E. So here's the calculation. How many elements are in E complement? The first student can have any of 365 birthdays. Then the second student must have a different birthday. So there's 364 days left for the second student. Then the third student must have a different birthday from both of the first two students. So there's 363 different possible birthdays for the third student, and so on. We're calculating 365 multiplied by 364, multiplied by 363, multiplied by 362, etc. In other words, we're doing 365 factorial divided by 335 factorial, or in terms of permutations, that is 365 permute 30. And then the probability of E complement, we can write down as 365 factorial divided by 335 factorial multiplied by 365 to the power of 30. And then the probability of E, the probability that two or more students have the same birthday. There's a typo here, this should be C just here. The probability of E is 1 minus probability of E complement. And when we use our calculator to calculate this, we get approximately 0.706. In other words, in a class of 30 students, the probability that two or more students have the same birthday is approximately 70%. So that was unions, intersections, and complements. Next type of probability that we're going to look at is the idea of conditional probability. Sometimes the probability of an event will depend on another event. For example, if we suppose that A is Ali has cancer and B is Ali is a smoker, then clearly these two are related. We know that smokers are more likely to get cancer. So clearly the probability that A occurs depends on whether or not B occurs, or whether or not B is true. The conditional probability of A given B, which we write like this. Probability of A line B. The probability that A occurs if we already know that B occurs. And we have a nice formula for the probability of A line B. The conditional probability of A given B is the probability of A intersection B divided by the probability of B. That's the probability that both A and B occur divided by the probability that B occurs. For example, a bag contains red and blue marbles. Two marbles are drawn randomly without replacement. We take two marbles out and we don't put them back in the bag. The probability of selecting a red marble first and then a blue marble is 0.28. The probability of selecting a red marble on the first draw is 0.5. What is the probability of selecting a blue marble on the second draw if we know that the first marble was red? Let's define some events. Let R be the probability that the first marble we take out of the bag is red. And let B be the probability that the second marble that we take out of the bag is blue. We're asked to calculate the probability of B if we already know that R is true. So we use the formula probability of B intersection R divided by the probability of R. We put in the numbers from the question. 0.28 and 0.5, and we get our answer 0.56. Next example. Your friend says that when she rolled a die, she rolled an odd number. What is the probability that your friend rolled a fruit? Let A be the event that your friend rolled a 3. Now, clearly the probability that she rolled a 3 is 1 over 6. But that's not the answer to this question because she's already told us that she rolled an odd number. So we know that she didn't roll 2, 4, or 6. We already know that she rolled either 1, 3, or 5. The probability that she rolled an odd number is a half. It's half of the numbers are even and half of them are odd. You'll also notice that the probability of A intersection B, what is the probability that she rolled a 3 and she rolled an odd number? 3 is an odd number, so again, this is just 1 over 6. Then we have the information that we need. We can use our formula. The probability of A given B is the probability of A intersection B divided by the probability of B. Put these numbers in and we get 1/3. We know that she rolled an odd number. We know that she rolled either 1, 3, or 5. What is the probability that she rolled a 3? That's 1 in 3. That hopefully makes sense. Let's play with this formula. We have the formula that the probability of A given B is the probability of A intersection B divided by the probability of B. Multiply both sides by the probability of B, we get the probability of A intersection B is the probability of B multiplied by the probability of A intersection B. Now, what we could do is we could swap A and B. Instead of probability of A intersection B, we could write the probability of B intersection A. And all we would do is we would swap A and B in the right side. So we would get the probability of A multiplied by the probability of B intersection A. And of course, A intersection B is the same as B intersection A. Therefore, the probability of A intersection B is both the probability of A, probability of B given A, and the probability of B, probability of A given B, which we can rearrange to the probability of A given B is the same as the probability of A, probability of B given A divided by the probability of B. For the next example, I want to talk about a famous probability problem called the Monty Hall problem. Let's suppose you're on a TV game show and you're given the choice of 3 doors. Behind one of the doors is a car, behind the other 2 doors are goats. And obviously you want to win the car. You pick a door. Let's suppose, for the sake of argument, that you pick door number 1. And the host of the game show, who knows where the car is and where the goats are, opens another door. Let's just say that the host opens door number 3 and shows you that there's a goat behind door number 3. Then there's 2 closed doors. There's door number 1, which you've previously chosen, and the other door, door number 2. The host says to you, do you want to change your mind and pick door number 2 instead of door number 1? Should you switch your choice? Should you stay with your first choice, stay with door number 1, or should you change your mind and now pick door number 2? Monty Hall problem is named after an American TV presenter called Monty Hall. And this is a problem which confuses a lot of people who haven't studied probability. So, let's talk about this problem. With there's 3 doors, one car and 2 goats. The car might be behind door number 1, the car might be behind door number 2, or the car might be behind door number 3. You can open 1 door and you win what's behind the door. And you don't want to win a goat, you want to win a car. You choose a door at random. What is the probability that the car is behind the door that you choose? This is easy, right? The probability that the car is behind your door is 1/3. Yes. Then the host opens another door and he shows you a goat. Now, are two closed doors. Behind one of these doors is a car, and behind the other door is a goat. What is the probability is that the car is behind the door that you chose? Two closed doors. One of them has a car behind, one of them has a goat behind. So clearly now the probability that a car is behind your door is half, right? Wrong. This is what confuses a lot of people, so this is what we're going to talk about now. To understand what's happening, let's look at all the possible outcomes if we choose door number one first. All of the doors are the same, so it doesn't matter which door we choose. Just for the sake of this argument, let's suppose that you choose door number one first. First of all, let's suppose the car is behind door number one and goats are behind door number two and door number three. And let's suppose that the host opens door number three. And then the host says, would you like to stay with door number one or would you like to change to door number two? If you stay with door number one, then you win the car. If you change your mind, you choose door number two, then you lose. Now let's suppose that the car is behind door number two. You choose door number one. The host opens door number three, and he shows you that there's a goat behind door number two. And then he says, do you want to stay with door number one, or would you like to change to door number two? If you stay with door number one, then you lose. If you change your mind and you say, I want door number two instead, then you win the car. Or the third possibility is that the car is behind door number three. Again, you choose door number one first. And the host opens door number two, and he shows you that there's a goat behind door number two. Then the host says, would you like to stay with door number one, or would you like to change your mind and have door number three? If you stay with door number one, then you lose. If you change your mind, then you win the car. But look here. If we don't change our mind, if we always stay with the first door, then there's a 1 in 3 possibility that we win. If we do change our mind and switch to the other door, then there's a 2 in 3 chance that we win. We can see from the table that if you don't change your mind, you have a 1 in 3 chance of winning. If you do change your mind, then you have a 2 in 3 chance of winning. These are the probabilities if you choose door number one first. But because all three doors are the same, it doesn't matter if we choose door number two or door number three first. We would get the same results. 1 in 3 chance of winning if we don't change our mind, but 2 in 3 chance of winning if we do change our mind. Let's think about this in another way. Let's suppose again that first you choose door number one. At the start, the chance that the car is behind door number one is 1/3. And the chance that the car is behind either door number two or door number three is 2/3. Let's imagine a slightly different problem. Let's suppose that the host doesn't open a door. He just says you could either stick with door number one or you can have both door number two and door number three. Would you change your mind then? Would you stay at door number one? Or would you have door number two and door number three? We know that at least one of door two and door three hides a goat. So if the host opens either door two or door three, he doesn't open it at random. He knows where the car is, he knows where the goats are. So he's always going to open the door with a goat behind. If the host knows that the car is behind door number two, he will open door number three. If the host knows that the car is behind door number three, he will open door number two. If the host knows that the car is behind door number one, then sometimes he'll open two, sometimes he'll open three. But always he opens a door with a goat behind. So the goat isn't giving us any extra information. That means the probabilities don't change to a half and half. It stays as one third if we don't change our mind, or two thirds if we do change our mind. Let's think about this one more way. Let's think about this problem using conditional probabilities. Let's suppose that C is that door number one has a car behind it, and C complement is the probability that door number one does not have a car behind it. Or to say this another way, C complement is door number one has a goat behind it. Let E be the event that the host opens a door with a goat behind it. Now let's put some numbers in. The probability that car is behind door number one is one third. So the probability that a goat is behind door number one is two thirds. Moreover, if a car is behind door number one, what is the probability that the host opens the door with a goat behind it? Probability is one, because he always opens a door with a goat behind it. What is the probability that the host opens a door with a goat behind it if there's a goat behind door number one? Again, this is equal to one, because the host always opens a door with a goat behind it. Then we can calculate. This is the formula from the previous theorem. Probability of C given E is the same as probability of C. Probability of E given C divided by the probability of E. And the probability of E is the same as the probability of E intersection C plus the probability of E intersection C complement. And the probability of E intersection E complement from a formula we've had is the same as the probability of C, probability of E given C, and the probability of E intersection E complement is the probability of C complement, probability of E given C complement. There's nothing complicated here, it's just using the formulae that we've seen already today. Then we put the numbers in and we calculate that this is equal to one third. The probability that the car is behind door number one, if at the start of the problem is a third, the probability that the car is behind door number one after the host opens a door with a goat is still one third. The probability of where the car is doesn't change if the host opens a door. The probability that the car is behind door number one is always one third. So in conclusion, if you're playing the Monty Hall game, you should always switch your choice if you want to win the car. The third and final chapter from today is the chapter about probability trees. To start with, first example, let's suppose a box contains 3 red balls and 2 yellow balls. 2 balls are randomly taken out of the box and they're not put back into the box. What is the probability that the second ball that we take is yellow? To understand a situation like this, we can draw a probability tree. To start with, the first ball that we take out of the box can be either yellow or red. There are 2 yellow balls out of 5, so the probability that the first ball is yellow is 2/5. And the probability that the first ball is red is 3/5. Then we take a second ball out of the box. The ball can be either yellow or red. Let's look up here first of all. If the first ball is yellow, then there are 4 balls left in the box, 1 yellow ball and 3 red balls. So now the probability that the second ball is yellow is 1/4. The probability that the second ball is red is 3/4. Then let's look down here. Let's suppose that the first ball that we draw is red. Then we have 2 yellow balls and 2 red balls. Probability of getting the yellow ball is 2/4. The probability of getting the red ball is 2/4. Then using the multiplication principle, we can multiply these numbers together. Probability of getting yellow and then yellow is 2/5 multiplied by 1/4. Or 1/10. The probability of getting yellow first and red second is 2/5 multiplied by 3/4. The probability of getting red and then yellow is 3/5 multiplied by 2/4. And the probability of getting red and then red is 3/5 multiplied by 2/4. We're interested in getting a yellow ball second. We can either have yellow, which has a probability of 1/10, or we can have red, yellow, which has a probability of 3/10. Add these together. The probability of getting yellow plus the probability of getting red, yellow is 4/10 or 2/5. So the probability that the second ball is yellow is 2/5. And this makes sense, right? We have 5 balls, 2 of which are yellow. The probability of getting the yellow at any time should be 2/5. Next example. Jeremy and Kia are playing tennis. The first player to win 2 sets wins the match. In each set, the probability that Kia wins the set is 2/3. And therefore the probability that Boris wins the set is 1/3. Find the probability that Boris wins the match. Find the probability that 3 sets are played. Find the probability that the player who wins the first set also wins the match. To understand this situation, we can draw a probability tree. For the first set, either Kia or Boris wins. Again, second set, either Kia or Boris wins. If Kia wins the first two sets, then we stop. We don't need to play a third set. If Kia wins and then Boris wins, then again, we play the third set, either Kia or Boris wins. Likewise, in the bottom half, if Boris wins and then Kia wins, we play the third set. If Boris wins both of the first two sets, then the game finishes. And in each one of these sets, the probability that Kia wins is 2/3. The probability that Boris wins is 1/3. And we can calculate the probability of each one of these branches. For example, the probability of KK is 4/9, or the probability of, let's say, BKB, 1/3 multiplied by 2/3 multiplied by 1/3, or 2/27. I lost connection for a moment. I hope you can hear me now. What is the probability that Boris wins the match? How can Boris win? Boris needs to win two sets. We could either have KBB, BKB, or BB. We're adding up the probabilities 2/27 plus 2/27 plus 1/9, which adds up to 7/27. What is the probability that three sets are played? We could have KBK, KBB, BKK, or BKB. You add these probabilities together. The probability that three sets are played is 4/9. What is the probability that the player who wins the first set also wins the match? We could have KK, we could have KBK, we could have BKB, or we could have BB. Add these numbers together, we get 7/9. Next example. You're given this probability tree and you're asked to calculate the probability of B. B here, there's a B here, there's a B here, and there's also a B here. How can we finish at B? We could have RMB, RNB, SOB, or SB. Then we put the numbers in, take the numbers from the probability tree, and we can calculate that the probability of B is 79 divided by 100. And then the final example for today's lesson. Ron Weasley has a bag with 7 blue sweets and 3 red sweets in it. He takes a sweet at random from the bag, and then he puts the sweet back in the bag. Then he picks a sweet at random and he eats it. That means that there's only 9 sweets left. Finally, he picks a third sweet at random from the bag. Draw a probability tree to represent this situation. We can have 3 steps in our probability tree. First, he'll take a sweet at random, either blue or red, and then he'll put it back. For the second set of branches, he will take a sweet at random and he's going to eat it. 10 sweets, he'll choose 1 at random. And then on the third branch, there's 9 sweets remaining, and he picks one of these 9 sweets at random. I've noted at the top, we're starting with 7 blue sweets and 3 red sweets. The first sweet can be either blue or red. 7 of the sweets are blue, 3 of them are red, so the probability of him choosing a blue sweet is 7 over 10. The probability of choosing a red sweet is 3 over 10. He puts the sweet back in the bag and then he chooses a sweet at random. Again, this sweet could be either blue or red, and again, the probabilities are 7 over 10 and 3 over 10. The second sweet he does not put back in the bag. Instead, he eats the second sweet. That means there's only 9 sweets remaining. The third sweet can be either blue or red, but depending on which colour sweet he's eaten, the probabilities will change. If he eats the blue sweet, the probability of choosing a blue sweet is now 6 over 9. But if he eats a red sweet, then the probability of choosing a blue sweet is now 7 over 9. And this is the end of today's lesson. Next week, we will not have a lesson. Next week will be the midterm exam. And this will cover chapters 1 to 22. I'm not going to ask questions specifically from the introduction. I'm going to ask questions about the geometry of space and questions about combinatorics and probability. Do you have any questions?